to really get understanding of how that baby changes everything, we need to go to the Word of God. We need to ask the Spirit of God, the real Spirit of Christmas, to come down upon us in order that we might be able to approach this Christmas totally different. Let's go to Him in prayer. Father God, I come to You in the midst of the needs that we're facing as a country. And I'm asking You, Lord God, to divinely intervene and open up our spiritual eyes that we may be able to see Christmas in a new light and how the hope of Christmas can change everything. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. When Mary heard that she was going to have a baby, this is what she declared in Luke chapter 1, verse 52. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but lifted up the humble. He's filled the hungry with good things, but have sent the rich away empty. The story of Mary and Joseph traveling to Bethlehem as a homeless couple to have a census before Caesar Augustus. And then she conceives and gives birth to a child. Everything begins to change. In fact, history from then on is B.C. and A.D. And that same change can come into our lives when we take a moment and reflect upon a Christmas story that turns things upside down and inside out, giving us a Christmas spirit that changes everything. First and foremost, each and every one of us. Then once we experience this transformation, the way we begin to look at life, our worldview begins to change. We get into God's Word, and we begin to see that here is a baby that's laid in a manger, wrapped in rags, swaddling clothes, because there was no room in the inn. He's come to turn the system as we know it, inside out, upside down, and the plot thickens. What we see happening as we study the Christmas story is that society's second-class citizens, for example, the shepherds who are in the fringe of society, suddenly thrust in the middle of it all when they hear this heavenly host declaring, "Behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, Christ the King." And what a Savior He was. What a King He is as we study the Scriptures and we get down deep into it. The angel also said, "Do not be afraid." And so as we get it deep into it, we're also reminded, do not be afraid. Mary was told not to be afraid. Zechariah, who's also part of the story, was told to not be afraid. Joseph was told not to be afraid. Now the angels tell the shepherds, do not be afraid. For behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, is Christ the Lord. Even in the midst of a pandemic, we're told, do not be afraid. A baby has been born, and that baby changes everything. When we get a real meaning of Christmas, and the Christmas spirit comes upon us, we'll begin to see things also in a totally different light. We'll begin to see that life involves more than get, grab, hoard, and hold. It involves more than just storing up our treasures here on earth where moth and rust can destroy, as this baby when he became a man declares. It turns a system of corruption, oppression, upside down and inside out. We continue to study the Word. We see how He transformed everything. As He said, behold, I bring you a Savior. A Savior. Do not be afraid. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And that Savior begins to touch every area of our lives. We do not have to live in a panic. We don't have to wonder what the new year is going to bring, what the economy is going to do, what's going to happen, will there be a vaccine for the next pandemic or this pandemic. We can begin to experience His peace that passes all understanding because this baby is no ordinary baby. He's fully God. He became fully man. He wasn't born in the palace. He was laid in a manger. And those who feel like they're out, so to speak, a system that makes you feel like you just really aren't worth much because you don't have a lot of money you can donate to politicians. You think they want to run all over you, and only once they get your vote, they'll do whatever they want to do. You're important. You're important. Maybe you might be homeless, on the verge of homeless, down and out, not have the money to put everything under the Christmas tree that you need or think you need or want for those you love. But you can begin to experience a spirit of joy, a spirit of peace that transforms your life and then begins to radiate into the lives of those that are around you. As we get before God and experience this Christmas spirit, everything changes. So we must get into God's Word and take a look at what He has to say and to see that what happened when this baby became a man. That's what's so exciting about the book of Luke. Got the Christmas story, but it continues to tell the rest of the story, like Matthew, of course, Mark, and John. But here's what He had to say in Luke chapter, we'll take a look here, Luke chapter 4, 18 and 19, where Jesus quotes Isaiah 61, 1 and 2, where He declares, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because He's anointed me to preach the good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight to the blind, to release the oppressed, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And then he goes on and he adds the following in verse 21. Today the scripture is being fulfilled in your hearing. Wow. After Jesus said this, they all thought they'd be beneficiaries of this favor immediately. And they want to press him to get the good life immediately. But Jesus begins to turn their lives upside down. He begins to show them that there's more to life than just how much stuff is under the Christmas tree or how much stuff we possess. He begins to show us a new way of life. Now, the system doesn't like that. It upsets the apple cart, so to speak. They're angry. They're frustrated. You see that at first they want to try to stone Jesus, but he walks out in the midst of it. And he continues to proclaim that good news, a good news that transforms every aspect of life, a good news proclaimed right here in God's Word. And he goes on to changes things. And this is what he goes on to say. He says in Luke 6, 20 through 22, blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who hunger now, for you'll be satisfied. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when men and women hate you, when they insult you and reject your name as evil because of the Son of Man. Jesus identifies totally with the down and outer. In Luke chapter 9, verse 58, he said that foxes have holes and birds have nests, but he, the Son of Man, had nowhere to lay his head. That's why New Life Evangelistic Center at 1411 Locust has the homeless Jesus statue out there. It's out there to comfort the afflicted and afflict the comfortable. And Luke tells us that in his gospel that everything is turned upside down when Jesus comes. And that's what experiencing the Christ to Christmas is all about. Experiencing him working in us and through us. And I've got to admit that when all the powers that be shut down 1411 Locust, I had to have God do a work within me. It was such a temptation to get bitter because I saw the corruption firsthand. I saw the bigotry firsthand that so many have to live with day after day. I saw how just because people are poor and needy, rich folks move in the neighborhood wanted to shove them out. And every time I'd see some yuppie or whoever it might be with money walking down the street, walking their dog, streets that the homeless used to be on, streets that the homeless were able to get in line and come in and get shelter and food. Now I know where they're sleeping out there and how they're suffering. Oh, I'd feel the anger rise up in me. I'd start to feel the bitterness come in. And I knew that I couldn't get more bitter as I got older. I had to get better. So I had to let that Christmas spirit change me so I could begin to understand the fear that they felt of people that were different. Didn't excuse it. Continuing to work to get back in the building. But at the same time, I couldn't love them as Jesus loved the rich man if at the time I despised them. Because here they're living in their own abject poverty, a poverty of spirit, without purpose and objective except to get more and more stuff. And when they move into an area where the homeless already are, they think more about their property values than that suffering person that now has to eat out of a trash can or sleep behind a building somewhere or hide from the police by day because they'll tell them to move on. And because the rich folks will call them, the police, and harass them until they harass the homeless. And it's so easy to get bitter towards those individuals. But I had to let God change me. I had to let the Christmas spirit change my attitude, change my life, and begin to love them. For as Jesus was hung upon that cross, remember, he changed everything. He bridged the gap between creeds and deeds, and he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. So many people are blinded by their wealth. So many people are blinded by their money. They can't love their fellow man. They'll just walk around those that are hurting and needy and with disgust. And they start, their war on poverty is the war on the impoverished. They make excuses. Well, that guy's homeless because he's a drunk. They don't see what drove him into that alcoholism. They don't see the broken life that was there. They don't see the crushed. They don't see them as individuals like God sees them. They can't hear God's Spirit speak to them when God says, help them. They're cold and they're hard and they need Jesus. We've got to love the unlovable. In order to do that, we have to let Christ change us because that baby that changes everything doesn't just cause us to see how other people need to change. But when we find ourselves pointing a finger at them, we've got all these fingers pointing back at us. I needed that Christmas spirit. So as I began to pray, I began to feel God working within me. And right now we need to pray for that Christmas spirit to work in Washington, D.C., where there's such polarization. So one group says, well, we're the Christian party. Those others have this, this, and this. The other ones look at them and say, they don't care about anybody. And so there's this bitterness and hatred and clashing. And just continue on. Until these people who really think that they're Christians
and are part of a Christian nation are going to get down before God and say, God, I can't change the world, but I can let you change me right now. I can let the babe that's born at Christmas begin to work in my life. I can get real over the sin in my life. I've had to do that. And it don't just happen one time. It's a daily dying to self and being resurrected to Christ Jesus. It's spelling this word sin backwards, that Jesus came on that cross and died for. Instead of S-I-N, it's N-I-S. Now I surrender. I need that baby that came at Christmas to change everything, including my spirit. And if you're honest with God, I think if you look down and deep in your heart, you're going to see there's roots of bitterness that have gotten in there over the years. There's been hurt. There's been pain. You may have encountered distinctly social injustice. You may have been abused by police, and now you see all police is bad. I mean, you may have been had somebody steal from you of a certain nationality or race, and now you think they're all bad. That's bigotry. We've got to let God get down in our hearts and change us. We have to say, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. I need that baby that changes everything. So as the angel appears to Mary and says, do not be afraid, and begins to tell her that she's going to bring forth a baby that's going to change everything. We need to open our hearts and minds and spirits and let it begin with each one of us. Let the Christmas spirit that changed everything become ours today. Now, if we really want to experience the change that that baby gives, we need to take a look again at the Word of God and what He said to Mary, Zechariah, the angels, and the shepherds, Simeon, and Anna, and how they all experienced it as we take a look at Luke chapter 1 and 2. So here's Mary. You saw some of that, and you hear some of that earlier, but let's take a look at what Mary had to say again in Luke chapter 1, 46 through 47, where she says, my soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior. She shows that the Christmas spirit comes within, from within, and spills out to all concern. And then, as she shows this, she directly addresses the social injustice that exists in this world. We have to do that. But we have to understand people are suffering, and we're supposed to be changers because Christ, the hope of glory, lives within us, and we're not going to keep making excuses for these injustices. So she goes on and declares in Luke chapter 1, 50 to 53, His, God's mercy, extends to those who fear Him from generation to generation. He's performed mighty deeds with His arm. He's scattered those who are proud in their innermost thoughts. He's brought down rulers from their thrones, but have lifted up the humble. He's filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. And that's what they are. They're empty people walking around. We got to pray for God's love, to love those empty people, that we can show them that there's more to life than just the accumulation of stuff. They got all this stuff where the kids are waiting for them to die so they can get it all. They've never seen a funeral hearse, like I said, with a U-Haul trailer behind it. You can't take it with you. So let's let our light shine. Let's let our love flow. Instead of just giving Christmas gifts to each other this Christmas, let's give gifts to the one, the Savior, who's changed everything. And how do we give Him a Christmas gift? He said, as oft you've done to the least of these, even so you've done unto me, as we reach out and love the hurting, the homeless, those that have nothing. Jesus is turning the system upside down. We'll go and take a look. Zechariah, he declares God's righteousness and justice when he says in Luke 1, 77 to 79, because of the tender mercy of our God, by which the rising sun will come to us from heaven to shine on those living in darkness and the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the path of peace. Guide our feet into the path of peace. And oh, in this country, it hadn't been so divided since the Civil War. How we need to have Him guide our feet to the path of peace. So get off your high horse. Stop thinking that, you know, you got it all right and everybody else got it all wrong. God needs to just have all of us come before Him and let Him change each and every one of us. Okay, and then back to the angels that we mentioned to earlier. Once again, we see the angels proclaiming the Christmas message in Luke chapter 2, verse 14, where it says, glory to God in the highest, and earth peace to them, to men and women on whom His favor rests. And once the shepherds experience this, we go on and see in that book of Luke, that they go and they tell everybody about it. Once we've experienced the good news, once the reality that Christ indeed is risen, once our eyes are open to the wonders of God all around us, we can't help but go and tell everybody, because we have a new world system. We have new world order. We have experienced the resurrected Christ, the Christ child that changes everything, including us. And we begin to have hope right now.
And we want to share that hope with everybody that we come in contact with. Christmas changes everything. Everything. And when Simeon saw the Christ child, he was so moved that he declared in Luke chapter 2, verses 29 through 32, "Lord, now lettest thou thy servant depart in peace according to thy word, for mine eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared before the face of all people, a light to lighten the Gentiles and the glory of thy people Israel." And there's 80-year-old Anna. She begins to experience it, the spirit of Christmas, and she shares in word and deed the hope of God. Oh, what a mighty God we share. Wow. We need to let God's light and love shine within us. So, come on. God is in control. Stop crying over the election. Stop thinking that a man's going to solve your problems. Come to the Christ of Christmas. And regardless of whatever political party you may be from, yours is not the only party. Yours is not the only right one. Let's come together. Let this once again become United States of America, one nation under God, and let there be peace on earth, goodwill to men and women like we never encountered before, because we've let the Christmas spirit change us. We've come, we've knelt before Him, and we also declare, yes, and don't be afraid right now. Some are afraid to totally turn it all over the Lord because they think that the Lord might turn this upside down, that upside down, and He may. He'll use your talents. He'll use your abilities. The things that you think you're enjoying now, once it's surrendered all to Jesus, you're going to see Him do extremely beyond what you can even ask or think. That's the God He is. He's created you this way. He's given you those talents and those abilities, and He wants them to come into full fruition. Read the last few verses of the book of Titus, and you'll see that we're warned not to engage in this silly controversy or that silly one and all those emotions that are brought around the tree on Christmas Day, but we're supposed to submit them to the Lord, and then do the good works that He's called us to do so we can truly be effective and productive. And through our lives, something can be done that's going to let our light so shine before men and women that we may be able to declare that there is indeed hope. Christ is risen. And it begins to change everything as we know it. So let's continue to dig into God's Word. Continue to dig into God's Word. And let's hear what Jesus is saying to us at this particular time in Matthew 13, 16, where He says, "Blessed are your eyes because they see and your ears because they hear." Wise men and wise women have their eyes and ears open, and they go a different route. They don't keep going Herod's route when they return home. You know, the wise men, Herod wanted them to come back and tell them where the Christ child was so he could kill them, but no, they were warned in a dream, and they went a different route. You and I have been warned through the Word of God, and we need to take a different route than what we've been taking right now. Look at all the Christmases that have been empty and dry and ineffective. And during this Christmas season, when we're challenged by pandemic, our families not all to get together and continue to spread it, then perhaps it's a Christmas that challenges us to approach it differently, where we're going to concentrate on getting it together with God. We're going to come into His presence. We're going to ask Him to develop a relationship in our lives with the Almighty, made possible through that Christ of Christmas, who came as a baby and changed everything. I want to encourage you to pick up the Word of God, read the Christmas story in the book of Luke, read it in the book of Matthew, and let it begin to work in your life till the words that Jesus says in John 14, 6 becomes a reality when He says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by Me." Then He goes on and says in John 14, 12, "Behold, I tell you the truth. If you believe in Me, you can do the very works I do. Yes, even greater things, because I'm going to the Father. Whatever you ask the Father in My name, I will do it." And so we've got this big problem. Maybe the family is falling apart. Maybe you just can't get an understanding of your wife. She can't get an understanding of you. And you feel like you're going this way rather than this way. And the children, they're every way. Wow. What do? We come before Him. And hear what Jesus says, "Behold, I tell you the truth. If you believe in Me, Father, God, thank You for sending Jesus. I believe in You, Jesus. I see Your wonders all around me, Lord. I see the miracles You've demonstrated through creation and through Your Word. I've seen the things that You've done and how You've brought me through this, that, and the other. I see, Lord God, how You fulfill the promises, hundreds of promises from the Old Testament filled through that baby who changes everything in His life, death, and resurrection. The reality is there. Over 500 people saw Him in His resurrected power. And now I want to surrender my life to You, Lord Jesus. Yes, because I want You to change me. Because You're the spirit of Christmas indeed lived out that changes everything." And then get into God's Word. Get into God's Word. Get in God's Word.
Yes, we have seen in Luke chapter 1 that Zechariah told not to be afraid, Mary told not to be afraid, the angels told not to be afraid, and now he's saying to you and I, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. It's God's free gift that he wants to bestow upon you at this time, and it's called grace. It's called grace. He wants to turn us upside down and inside out. Don't be afraid of what other people are going to say. Come on. Stop that drinking. Stop that doping. Stop trying to find this man or this woman or here, there, and everywhere. Jesus says, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And if you'll just do what Mary did in Luke chapter 1, verse 38, when she says, I am the Lord's Spirit, and may it be to me as you have said. We're invited to receive this new Christmas spirit. And the theme of the New Life Evangelistic Center, 2 Corinthians 5:17, can be ours. Anyone be in Christ, they're a new creation. The old has passed away, the new has come. And that's what we desire to proclaim. Whether it's feeding the hungry, sheltering the homeless, helping people break free from the cycle of homelessness, reaching out, and all of it, we want everyone to know that you can be a new creation in Christ Jesus, because the Christ of Christmas, the baby who came, changes everything. Changes everything. He'll change you. He'll change me. And you and I have hope both now and for all eternity. Thank you, Lord. And once that experience happens, like Mary in Luke chapter 1, 46 through 49, you'll declare, my soul glorifies the Lord and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the mighty one has done great things for me. Holy is his name. Jesus was born as a homeless child who was laid in a manger, as we see in Luke 2:7, because there was no room for him in the inn. We will never truly feel the spirit of Christmas until we have room in our heart for him, until we make room for him and allow him to come in. This involves letting Jesus be our Lord and Savior to the extent that we're going to let the Holy Spirit speak through us. As we hear, Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice, they know me and they follow me. We're going to ask him to give us that peace that passes all understanding when we develop the mind of Christ. And we can begin to hear the cries and the prayers of those that are going before God and saying, Lord, help me in this time of need. And then we're going to move out under the Spirit of God and we're going to try to help them. And as we do this and we see this and we encounter this, we're going to experience the Christmas spirit that changes everything. Let him speak to you now. Come to Jesus wherever you're at. Just declare, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. Now I surrender. I want to follow you, Lord. I want to come to you, Lord. I want you to change everything in my life. I want the same Holy Spirit that I read about in Genesis 1:1 that hovered over the waters, come in Genesis 1:1 and 2 and bring order to my life like you brought it to the world. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Come, Christmas Spirit, and change everything in me and about me, and help me to go forth as a child of God. If you'll let that be your Christmas prayer, you will indeed see him in a new way. You'll encounter him a new way. Everything will look different. He'll give you a new holy boldness and a peace and power that passes all understanding. May this be the greatest Christmas you ever experienced as you encounter that Christmas Spirit that changes everything. Living, resurrected, Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
As Reverend Larry Rice and the staff of NLEC ask Jesus Christ to strengthen them through the power of the Holy Spirit, you also can do the same. If you've never committed your life to Jesus Christ, you can do that now. Just ask him to forgive you for all of your sins and to be your Lord and Savior.